It's great to welcome to the program today Oren Etzioni, who's the founding CEO of the Allen Institute for Artificial Intelligence. Really appreciate your time today. Thank you.
It's my pleasure. Good, always good to talk to humans.
Right. So, I mean, okay, let's, for some in our audience who maybe have a general sense of the idea of artificial intelligence, the term machine learning, which I know you have a particular opinion about, and these sorts of issues, I think they may have a general awareness that there are people who are very scared about the potential of an artificial general intelligence, and there are others who have a very optimistic view of those same possibilities as maybe bringing Homo sapiens to a new level of learning and capabilities and medical advancements, etc. Can you kind of lay out the goalposts or the guideposts, as the term may be, of the perspectives on this issue, those who are pessimistic versus optimistic? What is the crux of this disagreement?
Well, the way I think about it is that the computer is a pencil. Okay, it's a very big pencil. It's a very sophisticated tool, is what I'm trying to say. And as with any powerful tool, it can be used for good or for bad. So there are people who worry about its impact on jobs, losing jobs, on privacy, losing privacy, the bias that it potentially can exhibit in its algorithms. So that's on the one side. And then there are people who can see its potential for discovering vaccines, like the COVID vaccine AI helped there, and see that benefit. There's also a group of people who really don't think of it as a tool. They think that somehow this pencil is going to escape and become a Death Star. And I, a little bit mocking of that point of view, because I think that it really is just a tool.
That's super interesting, because it's, we'll get to the why AI might be an exception, but in Neil Postman's book, Technopoly, which I think is from the early 90s, he has a very similar perspective in general about new technologies, which is there's sometimes this idea of new technology comes forward. Some people theorize or speculate about possible negative consequences. The next step is, well, let's figure out a way to get the positive, but not the negative. And his view is the positive and negative will all exist. It's a question of implementation, regulation, planning, and management, essentially, that you can't only have the good without the bad. Where some say AI is different is at least the theoretical ability of an artificial general intelligence to learn more quickly, more rapidly, in a way that gets it beyond whatever its sort of initial, I don't even know if programming is the right term. You'll tell me if that's even the right word to use. And so it's sort of outside of, you know, social media. Social media is created. It exists within certain bounds. It will have good and bad, and we can regulate and manage. The difference, at least in theory, with artificial intelligence would be that it can itself go beyond the guidelines and the borders that humans set for it. Does that make it different?
Well, let's first of all start with the fact that there is a universal and understandable fear about our role as humans and technology. And this goes all the way back to the Jewish legend of the golem, who was this robot, and to Frankenstein and so on. So for centuries, we've been worried in various ways that technology is going to have this outsized role. Now, it is possible, it is conceivable that one day that'll happen. So now the question is, how close or far are we from that apocalyptic vision? And my assessment, as somebody who's been working on this for 30 years and who's very steeped in this technology, seeing, you know, the latest thing as of just a few days ago is ChatGPT, which is this program you can have these amazing exchanges with. Maybe we'll talk about that. But my assessment is that we are still decades, if not centuries, away from that vision. So really what AI is today is a lot more like the next generation of software. So again, super powerful, changing the world, you know, your iPhone and so on, but still very much a tool that we can use. And the notion that it'll somehow escape and become a lot more than we expect is not really based on data. It's based on anxiety. When you look at the data, when you look at what these computers can do, they're amazing, but they're not autonomous, right? Even take the notion of self-driving cars, autonomous vehicles, other than the fact that they're not yet ready for prime time and effective, you still tell the car where to go, right? It'll keep you safer than ever eventually, but it doesn't suddenly decide, okay, you know, I want to go to Cleveland.
Yeah, and I can tell you as a Tesla driver, it's not exactly something to write home about right now, the technology, which I know you're aware of. There are some who I don't know if are actually taken seriously by folks like you, like Ray Kurzweil, who for more than a decade has been saying, we're actually now in that phase that you say is decades or even maybe hundreds of years away. We just can't tell because when you're in the middle of rapid change, it just seems slower. And in retrospect, we will realize it. You don't agree with that. You don't believe that that time you're describing is taking place right now.
I not only not agree with that, but again, I caution to look at the data, right? So what is Kurzweil, who again has an impressive history and technology, what's his basis for saying that? And you can also look at him saying a number of other amazing things, like we've reached the point where we're going to live forever and so on. I would say that he's a very optimistic individual.
Fair. Okay. That's fair to say. Let's talk a little bit about, you mentioned the chat technology. The Turing test is, for those who are not familiar, sort of an idea of when does an AI type technology get good enough at mimicking human conversation such that an actual human like you or I wouldn't be able to tell that we are not speaking to another human. And folks wrote in and they said, well, you know, you should ask about are Siri and Alexa like that? I think the answer is certainly not, right? Would you agree that they are not at that level?
Siri and Alexa are very simple, but this is something that's rapidly changing. So ChatGPT, which is this new chatbot, considered the best chatbot ever. It's reached, you know, more than a million users in 5 days. It's freely available on the internet. That one is getting close to passing the fabled Turing test.
Is that as big a milestone as decades of literature make it out to be? Or is it a curiosity that is self-contained enough that it does not necessarily mean, okay, now that gets us to some particular next level?
That is a great, great question. And I think the answer is that we've learned that various limits that we've set where we believe, gosh, a computer will never do that, get crossed. And that's in 1997, a computer beating Garry Kasparov, the world champion in chess.
Right.
More recently, a few years back, beating the world champion in Go. There was a recent computer program that plays the strategy game of diplomacy. And now we have the Turing test. But each time we realize that the computer is picking up an aspect of intelligence, but not the whole human level thing. And so particularly about the Turing test, New York Times reporter John Markov said that the Turing test is a test of human gullibility, right? So it is interacting in a way that seems human, but these programs don't really understand what's going on.
When we think about the different ways that artificial intelligence at a level that's slightly ahead of where it is now, but not yet at what you're describing to be decades or hundreds of years away. When we think about some of those possibilities, there's all sorts of different fields that we could talk about. If we talk about the medical field and the idea of using machine learning or whatever better term we may have for it, as well as big data when it comes to patient data, and learning an algorithm of questions that could be answered by a potential patient, the idea of incredibly accurate diagnosis often comes up in lots of literature as a use for this type of technology, and that it would take out the emotion that is there to some degree in a so-called real doctor, and that there's other benefits. In the field of medicine specifically, is that interesting to you? Is it likely? Or is there something big that's missing from those hypotheses that actually makes that not a very likely outcome in the next 5 to 10 years with such technology?
I think this is a great example of how powerful and beneficial computers can be along two dimensions. First of all, we can get much better diagnoses, as you suggested, based on more data and more analyses. And secondly, we can also make it much more widely available. There's so many rural areas, remote countries and regions where the kind of medicine that we're used to is just not available. And it's expensive to do it with humans. So if we can build programs accessible over the internet that can help, that's fantastic. Now, I think that the best use of this, certainly in the foreseeable future, isn't just the computer taking over completely, but my favorite definition of AI is not artificial intelligence, it's augmented intelligence. So imagine that you have a doctor with their experience, with their empathy, being aided with this indefatigable assistant that reads all the millions, literally millions of papers coming out, that's gathering all these statistics, and that's making recommendations to the doctor. Would you rather have your human doctor or your human doctor with this incredible tool at their disposal? It's a no-brainer.
It is. I guess to play devil's advocate, the trend of doctors sitting there looking at a screen rather than the patient is already pretty bad. And if the logistics of having the AI help have them more sucked into the computer screen, maybe the experience won't be better, but maybe the outcome would. I don't know.
Well, again, wonderful point. But I would say this: A, ultimately, we do care more about the outcome, particularly when it comes to critical things. But two, the reason that they're on the computer so much is because they have all this paperwork to fill out.
Yes.
Okay, this is not a product of AI. Now, AI systems are coming out right now that actually help to automatically fill out the paperwork. So I think in the very near future, we'll have the computer less, we'll have the doctor, interesting slip there. We'll have the doctor less on their computer doing that and more able to engage with the patient.
I think that would be a good thing. Last thing I want to ask you about, there all of these issues ultimately end up being political, right? Stem cell research becomes political, and so does vaccines, and everything becomes political. Is it safe to assume, and or is it already happening, that the political lines around AI are that those who are more conservative in their worldview are against this type of technology, they want to try to ban it in advance or prevent its development, and that those who are more socially liberal or progressive are more open to it? Or is it falling along different political lines?
Wow. I've never been asked that question. So David, wonderful question. And it is actually scrambling the political spectrum. And let me quickly illustrate why.
Yeah.
On the liberal side, there's a lot of concern about bias, racism, sexism, and these computer programs, these AI programs are data-based. And so they sometimes absorb bias from their data. Mm. So there's a lot of concern there. And on the conservative side, there's a lot of concern about geopolitical tension and the fact that China and others are attempting to become superpowers, if not dominant in AI. And so there's a very strong sense that we need to invest heavily in it, both for economic reasons and for national security. So there are people all over the spectrum, and it doesn't break out neatly.
We have been speaking with Dr. Oren Etzioni, who's the founding CEO of the Allen Institute for Artificial Intelligence. Super interesting, and I really appreciate your time today and joining me.
Thank you so much.